Corpol 3 provides comprehensive monitoring, diagnostic and therapeutic functions for treatment of emergency and intensive care patients. It's a portable device with a modular stretcher, which can be used as a defib monitor or as a full patient monitor in its own right. So as you can see here, this is the Corpol split down into its three component parts. You have the patient monitor, the patient box with the bag which is attached, which has all its consumables in, such as your blood pressure cuff and ECG monitoring, and then you have your defib. In addition to the Corpol 3, other components include transformer, its bracket, and the invasive pressure leads. As with all our AMA in CCAST, we have to perform a 373 and pre-user check. So what I'm going to do now is demonstrate on how we do this with the Corpol 3. The first thing we want to do is check to be performed unplugged from the main, so we can see that we're not plugged into anything. And then we're going to split it down into three module parts, okay? And so to do this, what we're going to do is press the clips on the top like so. And as you can see, I'm now detached from the defib, and then I'm also then going to disconnect from the patient box like so. And the first thing I'm going to check is the patient monitoring, so I can remove these out of the way. So the first thing we're going to do with the monitor is have a look at the physical checks. So first I'm going to check for any dirt and damage. So I'm going to have a little look at the monitor here, turn it round, check in for any dirt or anything, any spillages that seems to be onto the patient monitor. Once I'm happy that that's fine, I'm then going to have a look at the TMW asset number, which is this number here. And I'm also going to check that this number is matching to my other component parts, so on my defib and also on my patient box. I'm then going to have a look at the MDSS serviceability sticker and check that this is in date. And then the next thing I'm going to look at is the screen protector. So I want to check that this piece of plastic is on like so and that that's intact. The next thing I need to do is check my printer paper. So to do so, I'm just going to pull this clip down like so and I can check that I've got enough printer paper in there. Additional printer paper can be found in the Airways and Corpols should you require it throughout your mission. So the next thing we're going to do is remove and examine the battery into the compartment. We tend to normally do this pre-flight, but I'll just show you here, this is where the battery compartment is. And to get the battery out, what we would do is we would just press these levers like so, tilt the monitor and then the battery will come out. But I'll just show you a demonstration of the battery here and what it looks like. So the things we're going to be looking on this battery are any cracks, any missing parts, any heat damage or any leaks. So these batteries have to be replaced every 3 years, and that's MDSS's responsibility to do that. So in addition to the 3-year expiry that the battery has, it's also worth noting that depending on how the Corpol is together, whether it's as a whole unit or it's split down into component parts, affects the capacity of the battery. So for the monitor, it has an approximate running time of 4 hours. The patient box is 4 to 6 hours. The monitor and the patient box together is 6 to 8 hours. And the patient box, monitor and defib, so it all together, is 7 to 10 hours. It's worth noting as well that the defib will give you 200 shocks at 200 joules. Also, in regards to the Corpol with its battery charging, the charge status of the batteries is displayed on the main screen, which we'll point out a bit later. The charging for this is it takes an hour to get to 80% and 2 hours to 100%. The next thing we're going to look at now is the physical checks for the defibrillator. So as we did with the monitor, the first thing we're going to do is look for any dirt and damage. So again, having a good look at the defib, checking that there isn't anything on there, such as spills or anything like that. Making sure that we're inspecting all parts of it, such as the handle as well. Then again, we're going to look at the TMW asset number, and that can be found here. And just check, as we spoke previously, that these are matching with the other component parts. So we're also going to be looking at the defib pads, so we're just going to check that these are in date, and we would also have a good look at these by turning them around to make sure that they're intact. The other thing we want to be checking are these two magnetic strips, so these can be removed like so, and these are there just to hold the defib pads in place. So as you can see, they remove like so, and the reason why we're checking that these are here, because obviously this is potential FOD for when we're on the back of the aircraft, so we want to ensure before we start any mission that two are both there. Checking the shoulder strap, making sure that this is intact. There are no tears or any splits or anything in this. Also checking that these clips are nicely secured to the defib like so. Then we're going to check the tilt function on the Corpol, and to do this we're just going to apply a bit of pressure on top, tilt it back like so. And under here, this is where we can find the battery for the defib. And the same things we're going to check for this. We would remove this, look for any cracks, any missing parts, any heat damage or any leaks. Once we're happy with that, the next thing we will do is we're going to check the Therapy Master cable. Okay, so to do this, we're just going to remove and we just sort of squeeze there. And that comes out like so. And we're just going to be looking here again for any damage, checking that these two white clips are there. And then just having a look in there again for any dirt damage or anything that looks untoward with that. And we would just apply that back in like so. We're then going to check the physical checks on the patient box. So the first thing we need to do is detach the leads and remove from the case. So to do this, we're just going to unzip the bag here and remove these leads. And then we can just remove from the bag. So once you've removed it from the case, you're going to do as you have with the others. You're going to check for any dirt and damage, especially paying attention to these little ports here, like so. We're also going to check that the TMW asset number is matching to the other component parts. And then we're going to check the data card and cover, like so. So we're going to remove this, check that there's a card in there, and just check that this is attached. Again, we're going to remove and examine the battery compartment, and the battery on this is located just here. And we would only do this pre-flight. So once you've done all the physical checks on the patient box, the next thing you're going to do is inspect all the and examine all the cables and the consumables and looking again for any dirt and damage. So what you would do is you would take them out individually. For the purpose of this video, I'll just show you obviously one, but we would get all these leads out just to make sure that we're happy with them. Again, looking for any cracks or any dirt or any damage or anything that we can see to these leads prior to emission. So the last physical checks that we need to do are just to check the transformer and the bracket. So we're going to check again on both these pieces of consumables for any dirt and damage, check the TMW asset number again is matching to the other consumables, and then just going to check that MDSS serviceability sticker is in date. Once you've completed all the physical checks on the core poles, we can move on to the post-operational system test. To do this, all devices are to be connected mechanically. And we're going to switch on and confirm the following. So we switch on with this green button like so, and we should see that the jog dial briefly illuminates as it has done so. We're going to check as well that the display illuminates with curves and parameters. As you can see, it's about to come up onto the main screen. The next thing we need to go on to are the defibrillator function checks, and there's a few things that we need to be aware of prior to starting this. We must never test the defib alone. Also ensure the core poles is unplugged from the mains to test, so just doubly checking that it's not plugged in anywhere. Never touch this red master cable when the defib screen is active, which we'll see in a moment, and check that the DECG is to remain unplugged when not in use. So this is just the diagnostic lead that lives in here. So the first thing we're going to do is check one. And to do this, we're going to ensure the master cable is plugged into the contact socket. So we're just going to give this a good push in like so and just confirm that that's in. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to select the manual button. And we're going to ensure the soft key functionality. So we're going to press the 50, 100, 150 and 200. So the next thing we're going to do is select auto sync. So to do this, we're going to press this sync button down here. And we can make our way through this menu by either pressing like so, or we can select with the jog dial and then confirm with the jog dial button. Once we're happy with that, we're going to check the metronome ranges, and we're just going to check that these are in accordance with recess guidelines. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to check the energy range. So we're going to check that this goes all the way down to 2 with the jog dial and then all the way back up to 200, and we're just going to confirm that at 200 like so. So the next thing we're going to do is press charge to load the energy. So the charge button is just here. We're going to press this. That's obviously going to go up to the selected energy. And once it's charged, we're going to press the monitor to disarm. And we're going to confirm that that does that with no error. The next is check two. So to do this, we're going to select manual. Press charge to load the energy to 200, so the charge button again. And once that's charged, this time we're going to deliver the shock. So we're going to press and hold the shock button, which is this large red button here. We're going to press and hold and check that that was released with no error. We're going to we're going to come off this screen by pressing the monitor. So for check three, the first thing we need to do is check the seated paddle position. So if I turn this around like so, and we're just going to check that they're nicely seated in like so. We're then going to attach the Therapy Master cable to the paddle cable. So to do this, so the next thing we're going to do is attach the Therapy Master cable to the paddle cable. So this is a bit easier if you tilt the corpals. We're going to pull this out like so, and then we're going to attach this in. And you should hear a nice click. Then what we're going to do is we're going to select the manual button and check that we're at 200. And we're going to press one paddle button to load the energy. So if I turn this round, I'm going to press one button. This is obviously then going to go up to the 200 joules. And then I'm going to press both buttons at the same time to deliver the shock. And then we're going to press the monitor button to come out of that screen again. The next check is check four. So we're going to check our baby shock paddles. So these are our baby shock paddles, like so. So to do this, we will turn the corpals around again so it's easy for us to see. We are going to remove these paddles like so. And then we're going to attach them. And we should feel a nice click. Like so. Once we're happy that we're there and that our paddles are secure, we're going to select manual. And we're going to reduce our energy down to 10 with the jog dial button. What we will do then is we will press put the paddles together, press one button to charge the energy, and then we'll press shock to deliver. What we would need to do there is to check and observe that the little red button's illuminated. It would come out like so, and then we would press the monitor screen. Once we're happy with that, we're literally going to disconnect the baby shock paddles and then put the corpals back together. So once we have seated the paddles and reconnected the master cable, we can then go on to print out our protocol printout. So to do this, we're going to press the browser button, and this will obtain our protocol printout, basically an event log. Once we've got our printout, there's a few things we need to be checking on here. We need to check that our date and time is correct, as according to Zulu. Check that our VT and VF alarm is switched on. And then we're going to check the energy levels of the shocks that we delivered and check that they're within the plus or minus 15%. So we'll check our three shocks, and then we're also going to check our pediatric shock as well. So once we have done the corpals physical checks, we can move on to do the general functional checks. The first thing we're going to do is invert the screen, and we're going to do this by press and holding the monitor button. This might be useful if you've got glare on your screen. So if we wanted to revert from this, we just press and hold the monitor button again. The next thing we want to do is check the function of the pacer. So to do this, we're going to press the pacer button. We're going to select and check the frequency range. So press the frequency button, and we're going to turn this all the way up to 150 and all the way back down again, just to make sure that this is working. And we can confirm with the jog dial button. Once we have checked the frequency range, we can also then check the intensity range. And we do this by pressing the intensity button. As I dial this up, I want to be able to hear an audible alarm, and I also want to see the word stim come up. So we can see stim all the way to the top, and we can turn that all the way back down again. So what we're going to do now is we are going to check the monitoring component parts. So the first thing we're going to do is check the non-invasive blood pressure. So what we want to do is have a little look in here, just to check that it is connected into the side of the corpals. And then once we're happy with that, we're going to remove it from its pouch. Like so. And normally we would attach this to our arm, but for the purpose of this video, so you can see what I'm doing, I'm not going to do that for the moment. We would then press the non-invasive blood pressure button. We're going to check on here that our parameter screen is visible, and then we're going to press the start button. So I'm going to stop that there, so we would just press the close button and then we can pop this away. So according to the 373, the next thing we're going to check is the SATS probe. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to check in here that it's plugged in, which it is, and then we're going to remove it from its pouch. And we're just going to pop this on my finger like so. So once you have your SATS probe attached to your finger, you're going to check that your SATS come up, your pulse pressure and your pulse index are all visible. So the next thing we're going to do is check the temperature probe. So we're going to remove it again from its pouch. We're going to check that it's plugged in. And then we're going to attach a dummy test probe, like so. So what we're waiting to see is that this will record the temperature on here and go to room temperature. And we can check that this temperature is increasing by wrapping our hand around it. And as we can see, the number is going up. What we're going to do now is we are going to check our invasive blood pressure connections for all three leads. So what you need to do is, if we do our single one first, so we will just plug this into the P1 and P2 button on the side here. Like so. Then what you need is your pressure lead. And we're going to attach this like so. And then this is where your dummy transducer comes into play. And we're going to connect like this. And what we're wanting to see is where we have this dash line, that this goes into a solid line. And as we can see, that has done that on the screen. So what we would then do is then go and check all our pressure leads with the same principle. What we're going to do now is check our CO2 sensor. So to do this, we're going to go into the pouch, into the CO2 pouch, and we're going to get our testing cuvette out. We are going to attach these following the small triangles into the cuvette like so, and they should just click in. So what we want to be checking is that we can see our CO2 curve by blowing into the end of the cuvette. As we can see, it comes up like so. We also want to check that we've got our parameter and our respirate displayed. Then we're going to check the diagnostic ECG, and we do this by pressing this button here. And then we should just be able to see that all those SOCKEYs activate the 12 lead measurement, which it did. Once we're going to happy with that, we're then going to come out of that screen by pressing the cancel button. And then we're going to press the LT ECG screen. Just checking that that comes up, and then we're going to press the monitor button. The next thing we're going to do is check the views. So we're going to press the views button, and what we want to do as per 373, check that as we change the views that these parameters are on each view. So if we press view 1, view 2, and confirm, we're going to be checking that these all come in alignment with the 373. So the next thing we're going to check are the menu functional checks, and to do this we're going to press the jog dial to access the main menu and confirm the following. We're going to go into the alarm and scroll down into settings. I'm going to check that all volumes are set to 10, that the physiological tone is set at 5, the technical tone is at 4, and the VTF VR alarm is checked. And then we're going to press OK with the soft key. Once we're in the trend screen, we can check that the protocol group field is checked, and then we can check that the trends are also checked, the same as the screen, and this is set at 2 and this is set at 15. So once we're in our trend screen, the first thing we're going to check is that our protocol, in our protocol box, that our trends are set as checked. We're going to go look at the trends, check the same screen is checked, and your interval and average can be set as appropriate. Back into our main menu button, we're going to go into the defib. So if we click in there and we go into settings, in here we are going to check that alteration access code is unchecked. We are going to check that the energy levels for an adult are set at 200 and for a child are set at 50. We're going to check the AED mode, audio group field, that the AAM is checked, and that the AAM volume is set at 10. We're going to check the CPR menu group field, and check that the interval is set for 2 minutes. Once we've done that, we're going to come down here and press the metronome button. And on here, we're going to check the adult and child group fields is accordance to recess guidelines, so the 30-2 and the 15-2. And we're going to check that the compressed tone volume group field is also set at 10, which it is. We're going to check the vent tone group field is enabled, which is checked, and the volume is set at 10. Once we're happy with our defib screen, we can press the OK button to come out of that. Go back into our menu, and we're now going to go down into system. We're going to leave this patient screen, click into the system, and then we're going to go into settings. First thing we want to do is check that our language group field is set at English. We're going to check the time date group field is set at Zulu. So we are going to check that our set time is set at Zulu. We are going to also check our date is correct. We're going to go into the UT offset and check that that is set at 0. And then we're also going to come out of that, check that our autumn DST is also unchecked. Then we're going to go into the display group. We're going to check that our brightness is set at 10, our dim mode is 5, our auto dim is 5 minutes, and our colours are inverted. Moving on to the manual event, we're going to ensure that our voice recording is checked and our volume is set at 10. We're going to check the auto off group field, that all modules are set to 5 minutes, which they are. So the further final functional checks is we're going to press and hold the browser button, and this is to confirm that there is free memory space of above 25%. So if we press and hold this button, we can see that our memory is set there at 95% free. We're then going to separate the free modules and the status line between the connections. There should be a wave symbol that is present, and it should also give no error message. So if we're watching these lines here, we can see as if I disconnect there from the defib, there is now a dash flashing. So we just want to check that that's doing that. And then if we reconnect that, we can see that line has now gone solid. We're then going to check the battery remaining time. And the monitor in the patient box should be above 120 minutes. We then need to connect the patient box and the monitor to the bracket and a 48 amp battery. So what we're going to do now is we're going to connect the patient box and the monitor to the bracket. And I've already attached my bracket to my 48 amp battery just to ensure that this is going to charge. And as you can see, I now have an orange charge light. So once our core pulse is then uncharged, what we would do would be to press the off button, confirm that with OK, and that concludes the 373. So the first thing we're going to cover in this core pulse function lesson is reconfiguring a view. This would be useful if the views that are set up are not for what you need for your required patient. So the first thing we're going to do is go in and make ourselves a authorized user. So to do this, we're going to scroll down onto the menu button, go into system with the jog dial, and we're going to authorize this. So we go into authorization, we're going to put in the code 2222, and then we can now see that we have been logged on. So to reconfigure a view, we're going to go into the signal screen, go down into views. For the purpose of this, we'll use view 4 because this one is empty. So if we go across, select view 4, if we go into curves, and then if we select a curve off here, so if I just click on this one, then if I go into parameters, and then go and select, for example, one of the invasive blood pressure monitoring leads. It's important to note as well, you have to select horizontal and vertical. So if we go and select these, like so, go up onto the pressure lead, and then if we go into views, and then what we can do to make sure that comes up is press the back button, so this button here, and as you can see, it's now displayed. And then we would press the OK button. We would then go on to store that view. So to store that view, we would go into the menu button again, go into System, and go into Settings. We would then go down to Configuration, Store. As you can see, it's set at No. We'd say Yes. Happy with that. Configuration is now stored. We'd press the OK button, and now we know that that configuration has been stored for View 4. Another function that we need to be able to do with this core pulse is calibrate our transducer lines, and there are three methods to doing this. Bear in mind, we can only ever calibrate one transducer line at a time. So how we would do this is, for the purpose of this, we are connected to our patient and our transducer, and we're going to calibrate the P2 line. So if I go into the menu and I press the jog dial button, scroll down to the IBP, if I go into here, go calibrate P2, make sure that I am open to air. And then if I click in here, it is saying calibration in progress and calibration is successful. And as you can see, I've gone down to zero. So the other two methods on how you can calibrate your transducer line is you can do this through the curve screen. So if I go down and select the lead, so if I go into P2, and as you can see down there, it says for me to calibrate. So I do exactly the same process again. I'd hit the calibrate button and off to my patient. And then I can also do this by going into the parameters. For the parameters, I would just scroll down so I can get onto the parameter screen. And if I go into the P2 parameters, if I select in there with the jog dial button, again, you can see that I can select down to calibrate the line. So I would open to air and calibrate. So the other thing we want to be able to do with the core pulse is label our invasive lines. So to do this, we would go down into the curve. So if I go down into P2 for the line we've been using, I press select in here. And you can see I'm on the invasive blood pressure line. But if I go down to the dash dash, select in there, I can then label this line to whatever it is. So arterial blood pressure example. And select like so. Another function that this core pulse does is you are able to activate dynamic tones. Why this might be useful is if, for example, you're reintubating your patient and you want to be able to hear the tones when your patient's sats dropping, for example. So how we would do this is if we would go into the main menu button, so press the jog dial, go down to oximetry, go into settings, and as you can see here, we've got enable and dynamic on our acoustic signal. So if we check these boxes, and then if we press OK, we should hopefully, when we press this, be able to hear the sounds. And there are the sounds. What we're going to do now is look at how we perform a 12-lead ECG. So as you can see, I've already put my basic monitoring leads on. And it's important to note that once these are on, these then become my limb leads when I do my 12-lead ECG. So the first thing I need to do is check that my diagnostic lead is plugged in. We're then going to attach the rest of these leads. So remember here that your additional leads become your chest leads. So once you've attached your leads, if you go into ImpressD ECG, as you can see here, the ECG screen comes up. And then what we need to be doing here is waiting for this screen to fully load up for it to say that it's ready for DECG, which it is now saying. Then we're going to hit the start button. Once that's come up, we'll see a screen here that's going to ask us to put in some minimal data for our patient. So what we need to insert here is the patient's gender. And then if we go down and we select their age and press OK. So once you're happy with that, you just need to hit the start button. And here it will print out your ECG. The next function we're going to cover is non-invasive blood pressure. So to do this, press the NIBP button at the front of the screen. You'll see the screen will come up there. This is obviously where we're going to get all our results from when we've done a non-invasive blood pressure. To change a few things on here, we could be able to change our interval time for our blood pressure, so we would do this here. If we wanted to perform a non-invasive blood pressure, how we would do this is we would just press the start button. And as you can see, this is going to give us a result. So let's just cover now some of the printing options that the CorePort can do for us. The first one being the screen snapshot. If you press and hold the print soft key, this will give you a snapshot of your patient's obs. This is really useful when you're in the back of the ambulance and it's difficult to document your patient's ob. The other option is a protocol printout of a current mission. So to do this, what we need to do is hit our jog dial button and then go into the trend page. So if we scroll down to the trend page, and what we need to be ensuring here is that trend is selected, and then we just have a little check on what the trend we have currently set, so time-wise, and then we press OK. And then if we press the browser button, this will give us our protocol printout of our current mission. The other way to print out a protocol printout of any stored mission is to press and hold the browser soft key. You can then use the jog dial button to select the previous mission. So if I go down and select one, and then press the protocol soft key to print the mission. Another option is our trend page of our current mission. So to do this, what we would do is we would go into our jog dial menu again. Because we've already selected our trend interval previously, all we need to do is hit trend page and then this will print out for us. So that brings us to the end of the CorePort lesson. Thanks very much for engaging with it. You can see some safety critical points on your screen now and some useful information. If you want to do any further reading about the CorePort, you'll be able to refer to the DLE and you can see lots of useful resources on there, and we'll get lots of hands-on time on course.